probably all of you know, Massachusetts already has legalized medical marijuana and decriminalized possession of small amounts of marijuana. Question four on the November 8th ballot is a referendum seeking to legalize marijuana for adult recreational use in Massachusetts. However, tonight's event is not a traditional debate about the merits of question four. Rather, as the name implies, this forum aims to provide information that might help voters make informed decisions about question four or other policy matters as they relate to marijuana. In particular, the event will focus on public health implications and what the latest science tells us about the impact of marijuana on the developing brain. Each of our panelists will make a presentation. When those are done, we'll open the forum to comments and questions from the audience. You have two options. If you wish to speak, you can use one of the handheld microphones that that are being waved now. I think we have two. No, we have one. Okay, you use the handheld microphone that is will be available. And if you do speak, please, we'd like you to make a comment or ask a question and direct it to one of the panelists. You know, several may speak, but if you think it's particularly relevant to one panelist, please say that, give your name, and we'd ask you to limit those comments to a minute, please. Or you can write a question on the index cards, which are being distributed by Lori Loisel, and she will collect those and give those to me, and I'll read those questions. And we'll alternate back and forth. And lastly, let me just say that while there may be differing opinions expressed tonight, I ask that all of you be respectful and civil during this discussion. And I hope that all of you will leave with some new information that will help you make clearer decisions about, as we say, policy issues related to marijuana. Now, our panelists tonight, I'll go from my left down to the end of the table. Dr. Ruth Poti is a resident of Northfield, family physician with Valley Medical Group in Greenfield. She serves as medical director of the Franklin House of Correction and is also medical director for the newly opened Franklin Recovery Center in Greenfield. She has presented on the physiology of addiction at many, many places in the Pioneer Valley and beyond, and she has three teenage children. Joe McGuire is here tonight from Colorado Springs, Colorado. She's the chairwoman-elect of the International Board for the Drug and Alcohol Testing Industry Association and co-chair of the International Marijuana Education Committee. In 2013, she was appointed to serve on the Colorado Governor's Task Force, convened to recommend a legislative framework for the regulation of marijuana after the passage of Amendment 64, which legalized recreational marijuana in Colorado. As part of the taxation, banking, and civil law work group, she helped create recommendations for maintaining safe and drug-free workplaces. She works closely with national health experts to educate state and federal policymakers on the importance of public health as it relates to drug and alcohol prevention and best practices in screening services. State Representative John Sybak of South Hadley was first elected to the State House of Representatives in 2002, where he currently serves as chairman of the Joint Committee on Labor and Workforce Development and is co-chairman of the first Oral Health Legislative Caucus in the United States. Before joining the legislature, Representative Sybak also had considerable experience working with both as a researcher and clinician with various populations, people diagnosed with developmental disabilities, traumatic brain injury, HIV, and substance abuse. He has been a member of the South Hadley Drug and Alcohol Prevention Coalition and has worked closely with the Hampshire County and the Tobacco-Free Community Partnership for Hampshire and Franklin Counties. And finally, David Sullivan has been district attorney for the Northwestern District since January 2011. Before that, he was a trial attorney for 20 years, served as a city attorney for East Hampton for 3 years, and was registered of probate in Hampshire County for 8 years. as district attorney. David Sullivan has embraced the community prosecution model that blends smart and fair prosecutions, crime prevention, law enforcement partnerships, and community collaboration to build safer communities. Thank you to all of them, and now we'll get started.
I'm glad to be here with y'all. So nice. I usually give a really long talk, and I'm absolutely not giving a long talk. I'm giving a really brief talk. I always walk into a place, think, what am I supposed to be talking about? Do I have a talk on me? Am I supposed to be actually showing slides? So I'm going to show you some slides about teenage brain development. That's my focus right now today, and because other people are going to focus on different things. So let's talk about public health success story, and that is tobacco. We have decreased the amount that people smoke paper cigarettes in this country faster in the last 10 years than anybody ever thought possible. In fact, New England Journal 2 weeks ago came out with an article looking at the drop of tobacco use under Bill Clinton and then the drop under George W. Bush, and then this really rapid decline under the Obama administration, partly because of the policies that President Obama put into place to really make it so that people smoking, particularly young people smoking, was rapidly on the decline. So we have the lowest rates of cigarette smoking among high school seniors that we've ever had in history. It's down to 6% or less in most schools at this point. That is a public health success story. I think everybody can agree with that one. Tobacco is the number one killer in our country. If we follow along the Obama trajectory, there will be zero smoking by 2025. That's amazing. The problem is that as cigarettes have gone down, marijuana has gone up, and that is because the sense of harm with marijuana has gone down. If you ask the average 24 and younger, is marijuana harmful? They're like, no, it's all good. I mean, what do people hear from the average 25, 15-year-old? Anybody, what do you hear about marijuana?
It's not as bad as alcohol.
It's not as bad as alcohol, 100% of the time. What else?
I can focus better when I drive.
My brain is better. I study better. My anxiety is better. My sleep is better.
Not addictive.
Nobody ever gets addicted?
It's
natural. It's natural. I can grow in my backyard in Northfield. It's organic seed. It's all good. What else?
It's better than opioids for pain.
It's better than opioids for pain. Yeah. Thanks, Paul. That was great.
Things I hear.
Yeah, I know. No one ever dies if you can't overdose. So you guys have covered the list. So there's not only a decreased sense of harm, there's a great sense of health with marijuana. I'm a mom, teenagers, I take care of teenagers all day long, so this is the stuff I have coming at me. If you ask the average 15-year-old or 18-year-old, do you smoke cigarettes? They're like, no, that's disgusting. It's a massive change in how we perceive things, okay? So cigarettes have gone down, marijuana's gone up, the sense of harm with cigarettes has gone up, and the harm with marijuana has gone up. So let's talk about teenage brain development. We used to think brains were done at 12. We're very clear that between the ages of 12 and 24, very significant things happen as the brain develops. There's three specific things I'm going to talk about. And the first one is synaptic refinement. So we have tens of billions of neurons in our brain. And in fact, we do not need that many. And in fact, it is harmful to have that many. Between 12 and 24, you gotta clean house. You gotta get rid of many of those synapses in the brain. And there are times during this phase of 12 years where you are losing 30,000 synaptic connections a second. 30,000 a second are disappearing. This is your teenage brain doing everything it's supposed to do, which is trying to get itself nicely ordered again. And so it would be really great if they were doing wonderful activities at that moment, that they're losing 30,000 synaptic connections a second. So the next thing that happens while this teenage brain is developing is it myelinates or insulates efficient pathways. So pathways that you want to keep, connections you want to keep in the brain, this is all happening during this phase of teenage development. Critical stuff is happening during these teenage years. It's one of the reasons our teenage brains make us crazy as parents, right? Again, right here, talking about it. Huge amount of like swinging emotions and pushing the envelope, very strong sensation seeking, very physically motivated, like need to move my body a lot. Always searching for the herd. They gotta find their people. That's why peer pressure is a big thing when you're a teenager. When you're 28 and somebody tells you to do something stupid, you're like, that's stupid, I'm not gonna do that. But when you're 18, you're like, dude, that's an awesome idea, I'm in. Because part of this teenage developmental brain is they are trying to find their people. It's a desperate part of the evolution of the teenage brain. So this is the use it or lose it principle, and if you're not actively using these healthy parts of your brain, or in fact you're actually activating unhealthy parts of the brain, it is those pathways, those myelinated efficient paths that get lit up and get kept. It's one of the reasons why these brains, which again are amazing, why they are the ones that are at risk for both substance use but also of mental health disorders. So I'm not going to try to repeat stuff that other people are going to mention. I didn't sort of show my slides to anybody else. I didn't know what everybody else was doing. I do know that I know Senator Lewis's slides, what they look like. So just to remind you that there are many different cannabinoids in marijuana. THC is just one of them. And the third thing our brain is doing, as I said, it is reducing the number of synapses. It's ensheathing fast, efficient pathways. The third one is it lays down receptors. It lays down two specific receptors in the final cortex of the brain, dopamine and anandamide. Dopamine, for anybody who's ever seen my talks, I spent a huge amount of time on dopamine. It gives you deep pleasure. It's the thing that really gets you to survive. It's the thing that benefits and reminds you to find good water, good food, find a mate. It's the thing that gets disrupted with all addiction because the dopamine is spiked and you keep wanting to go back to it. I'm not going to, besides saying that dopamine is this incredibly important receptor that gets laid down during this time, I'm going to spend all my time on the receptor called anandamide. And the problem with this receptor is it's the receptor in the outer cortex of the brain that helps make the decision about what gets myelinated and what synapses stay or go. It is the mirror equivalent of THC. That is the problem. And the THC in the brain steps into that receptor. In fact, knocks out our natural neural receptor with its own THC receptor that locks itself in there. It disrupts the way the brain makes decisions, very specifically. I did not learn this in medical school because we actually did not know what this receptor was, which was when I was in medical school. I'm not that old. This is new stuff that we are learning about what it is that THC does to the developing brain. These are the receptors for THC, also anandamide in the brain. They're all in the outer cortex, and they're in that deep inner area. These are the last parts of the brain to develop. These are THC receptors throughout the body, so lots in the brain, but many throughout the gut. It's one of the reasons why marijuana and some of the other cannabinoids can help people with nausea, right? It's one of the reasons that I certify people for the medical marijuana cards when they have specific illnesses. I am one of the people that does that. I want to be clear. I support medical marijuana for certain conditions where it is where it's needed. I've toured this company right across the street. I believe in its use. I believe it should be studied. I think it was a bad decision by the Obama administration to not get that off schedule one. I need more data. I need more and more and more research on this. The sign in front of my house says we do not have enough information. That's what it says. So if I really feel like what we're going to soon learn about this drug in our community, particularly in the developing brain, we will regret this decision in the next 10 years, in the next 25 years. I'm not going to go through all of this. This is some of the stuff that happens. But what I want to talk about is what studies have shown us. So I've already made it clear, we don't study marijuana well in this country. Why don't we study it? Because it is a hard thing to study when you don't have federal money. And you can't study Schedule I drugs without federal funds. And no university is going to give you enough money that it's going to take to run a really good study of marijuana. You have to have federal funds to do this. And again, it's got to get off the Schedule I. We have to be able to study this. So most of the studies that we rely on come out of Europe, or they come out of Australia, New Zealand. The Dunedin study is the best known study. It was following teenagers who started using marijuana at the ages of 13, 14, 15, 16, and it followed them for the next 20 to 25 years. So that's a good study, like it's an expensive study. And it compared them to people who did not use marijuana as teenagers, and what did their brains look like 20 to 25 years later. So some of the worries there, issues with attention, memory, learning, poor educational and life outcomes, and a loss of IQ by 8 points. So the comparison between the 13 to 15 year olds who started marijuana and then looking at them when they were 38, they were down by 8 points drop in IQ, not an insignificant drop in IQ. Like I actually want my kids not to drop their IQ at all. But more importantly to me is the follow, which is a very strong sense of I didn't get to be where I meant to be in life. I'm dissatisfied with where I am. That was the real measure that study showed us. Is there an increased risk of psychosis? There's definitely an increased risk of earlier psychosis. And we know that 75% of all mental health disorders start during the teenage years, up to the age of 24, and that people with heavy use, and heavy use is just described as daily use, right? We're not talking about smoking a joint once a month. We're talking about daily use. But guess what? Most of our teenagers who are using marijuana are using it every day. I have kids in my practice who wake up in the morning, it's the first thing they do. 11 o'clock in the morning, they take another hit. Lunch break, bathroom break, with their homework, to go to bed at night. This is, by definition, heavy use, without any doubt. The use of this drug in our, my little personal Pioneer Valley Regional High School is incredibly high. It is high in every high school out there. So if you think you don't have marijuana in your school, you're crazy. You are crazy. So the studies show interruption of attention, verbal learning, memory, processing speed, even when they're not high. And this way, these were not actually, this is not based on the Dunedin study. This is the graph I like the most because I think it says a lot. So if you look at those light bars, and there's a light bar on the top on both of those charts, and that is zero use of marijuana, and you compare it to the dark bar. And the dark bar there is in their lifetime, between 15 and 21, 400 or more uses of marijuana. That's not so much, guys. If I'm telling you that I have kids, many kids in my practice who are using marijuana three, five times, six times a day, getting to 400 doesn't take much. Look at the difference between college graduation rates between the dark blue and the light blue, and look at the rates of unemployment between the dark blue and the light blue. These are my kids, right? I would like my kids to launch out of this planet and be fully actualized human beings. I would like them to be able to operate on my knee someday and change the lug nuts on my car. That's what I want. I want these things to happen. I want my kids and all of our kids to do well. I think adding another addictive substance into our society that is going to change the brain of this next generation or beyond is not of any health benefit to our future generations. We've gone through this before. We did this with tobacco. Right, we've done this whole routine of tobacco. Back in 1900, where there wasn't tobacco that was industrialized. And what did they do? They grew a more potent tobacco plant to make it more addictive with more nicotine in it. And then they changed the way that the nicotine was delivered into your system so it made it as addictive as possible. And what you're gonna see in the next set of slides or two sets of slides after me is how much more potent this drug has become because it has been industrialized. I want to be clear, I don't care if a 28-year-old goes home tonight and smokes some weed. I couldn't care less, right? I don't think it's any worse than alcohol. That's the one thing kids will say to me I don't disagree with. It is not worse than alcohol. Alcohol does a tremendous amount of damage to individuals and to society. All day long, I run a treatment center. People think it's full of people with an opiate use disorder. Half that place is people with alcohol use disorder whose lives are off the rails. And I don't think marijuana is certainly any worse than that. And if I could guarantee that nobody under the age of 24 had increased access to marijuana, I would support this measure, right? But I know that's not the case. I know as soon as this thing becomes legal, more and more and more kids will have access, and more of them will believe it's the right thing to do. That's just the way it all rolls out. So, you know, that's me just spilling it all out there. So again, increased use of marijuana from 15 to 21 was associated with lower relationship quality and lower life satisfaction. So again, 8-point drop in IQ. So I'm gonna actually stop now because other people are gonna say, but I do wanna just comment on the addictiveness. So when you talk about the most addictive substance out there, what is it? Besides sugar. It's not caffeine, actually. It is definitely sugar. You guys are close. Nicotine is the most addictive substance out there, right? 33% of people with a first hit are in. They're in for good. Heroin is, everybody thinks it would be heroin. It's like 23%, right? The first hit, 23% are in. When you look at the rates of addiction with marijuana, they actually aren't that high. They are lower than alcohol, they are lower than heroin. And in an average adult, if I started smoking weed, or my cohort started smoking for the first time now, only 9% of us would get addicted. So in an adult with first exposure, 9% addiction rate, that's low. When you start with a teenager, it's about 17%. That's a little higher. But that is all data based on the old marijuana. That is based on marijuana with a THC of 2.5% or less. That is one of our problems. So again, here we are barreling down this track right now with no information because today's marijuana is nothing like the marijuana that I had in my little public high school in Western Massachusetts. It is not even a remotely similar product. And the addiction rates, when you start looking at today's marijuana, look closer to 34 to 40%, which makes it a hell of a lot more like nicotine. The number one killer in our country has been nicotine. I do not think that marijuana is going to kill people at those rates, but I certainly do not think it has health benefit to this next generation at all. And so I'm going to leave the stage. I'm going to sit down and shut my mouth for a bit and let other people take over. Thank you.
Physician doing my tech work for me, so that's always a step up in the world. All right, thank you. So my name is Joe McGuire, and I'm going to walk around a little bit because I can't stand still and have my brain work at the same time. So I live in Colorado Springs. I've been there for 26 and a half years and raised my family there, born in Denver. Colorado's my home. And I was in workplace drug and alcohol testing when Coloradans voted on Amendment 64. We made recreational marijuana use part of our constitution in the state of Colorado. So it's a constitutional amendment. Yours looks different. I'll let your experts talk about that. So what did that look like? So we voted in November of 2012. On January 1st, 2013, personal use and personal home grows were legal, six plants per adult in a home. On January 1st, 2014, retail sales opened up. So we've had retail sales for about 2.5 years, but personal use was immediately available as were home grows. A lot of times you'll see on news shows that our retail stores are like high-end, you know, they look like boutiques and things, and those exist. There are a few of those, but primarily this is what an average retail shop looks like, and these are three in a row on the same street. This is Marijuana Row, or the Green Mile now, is what it's called. It used to be the Antique District, and that's pretty common, and unfortunately a lot of these are ending up in low economic neighborhoods, and that's a problem because in Denver right now, there are more marijuana facilities than Starbucks and McDonald's combined. You can even throw Walmart in here. By almost double. So what it amounts to, the equivalent, is one facility for every 47 people. And you can also grow in your home. So that's a lot of pot. And the reason I mention that is because what we heard by and large is we're going to control, we're going to tax and regulate. And the voters, that's what the voters really believe. We're going to control it, tax it, regulate it, and money for schools. And voters are frustrated by this right now because it's not what they anticipated. So I'm going to talk about some of the anticipated outcomes that we weren't expecting. So these are the main things that I want to hit because these were the talking points. And as we went through our phase of where you are now and listening to how this was going to work, and then going to the regulatory table and seeing how it actually turned out, it's been a bit frustrating to see how these things have not turned out exactly the way that we had hoped. So I'm just gonna hit through them really quickly because this is usually like a 90-minute presentation, so I'm just gonna hit real fast. One of the first things that happened that we realized was not what we expected was that the THC was unlimited. So in Amsterdam, where marijuana was decriminalized, THC is limited at 15 nanograms. So 15% THC is the limit in Amsterdam, and anything over that is considered a hard drug in Europe, most of Europe. Well, our bill allowed for 100% THC, and there were concerns. We went to the hearings for the Blue Book and said, well, what does this mean? And what we heard from the guys who wrote the amendment, and I've worked with them, I've been at the regulatory table with them, I have a lot of discussions with them, so you know, I'm not saying anything that you can't find in public record and a lot of other things. They said, don't worry about it, because you really can't get THC in marijuana over 20%. Now, we didn't know. I mean, they're the experts, you know, they're the ones who wrote the bill and brought it to Colorado, and so We thought, well, our sheriff was saying what we've got on the street right now in 2012 was about 12 to 15%. And compared to what you just heard, in the 70s, it was two to 3%. So I remember our mayor being on the radio and going, you know, it was 2 to 3% in the 70s, now it's 12 to 15%, that's a lot of THC. Well, you can't find 12 to 15% in Colorado anymore. Because we've seen a lot of GMO. We've seen a lot of Miracle-Gro just bought into the industry. So in the 60s and 70s, what you see on the left is what your sativa and indica plants look like. Now, over here on the right, that's a typical, a lot of folks are calling them trees, not plants in Colorado. So your normal crop, a healthy plant can yield about a pound per growing season. But we've also figured out ways in Colorado to expedite the growing season. So now we're getting four crops a year. So if I have my six plants in my basement or wherever I've got them, I don't know. I don't have them, so I'm just saying, just making this up. But if I have my six plants, my husband has his six plants, we've got 12 plants, and we get four growing seasons, we get a pound per plant per growing season, that's 48 pounds of pot a year that we can just grow inside of our home. That's a lot of marijuana. And we're seeing people who are co-oping and going into large homes, and they're setting up their grows indoors. And they're coming from all over the country to do that. So we've seen people pull out just thousands and thousands of pounds out of these things. And I, you know, what I hear from people as they travel around is, I didn't know that would happen. For instance, my neighborhood, I pulled into my driveway one day and I was like, whoa, the windows were up in my car. So I use air, I'm a diva, so air conditioning all the time, you know. Unless it's like January 2nd or something. But I pull in and I'm like, whoa, someone is smoking like right here. And there's nobody around because I just smelled it immediately. And full disclosure, I have a son who's a very committed marijuana user. And I know that smell. You know, it's familiar to me. So I couldn't see anyone, whatever. I pull in my garage and decide to go check my mail at the community mailbox, four doors down. And as I'm walking toward the mailbox, I'm like, wow, I mean, what's happening? And sure enough, when I get to the mailbox, I look up in the house right there next to the mailbox. They have these commercial vents pointing out of the garage window that weren't there the day before. And I mean, I think I might have been getting a contact high. Like, it was pretty strong right there. And so they set up a commercial grow in their garage. That's against the rules. They're not supposed to do that. And so it got taken out a few months later because of some other things that were going on in the home. But that's the kind of thing that people are a bit concerned about, is that lack of control. I'll come back to that in a minute. The other thing that we didn't anticipate were the edibles. So here we have products that are really attractive to kids. So lollipops, gummy candies, and many of you heard that in the last week or two, Colorado's changed policies on these. And what the policy change was is because we got a lot of heat for the gummy bears, we said you can no longer make those sweet treats in the shape of an animal. So no more bears and worms, but the rings and all of these other things are still legal in Colorado. The sodas are a challenge, knockoff products are a challenge, and one of the changes that has come from those THC content in those edibles, first of all, the edibles is 60% of the market in Colorado, 60%. So higher potencies, we've got 40, 50, 60, 70% THC. We did narrow down the serving size to 10 milligrams per serving, but it's a suggestion. And working on the task force work group where we talked about that, they don't have to be individually prepackaged. It's a suggestion, it's voluntary. We've asked that you demark those pieces of food into a serving size. Well, you can demark a candy bar, you know, like a Hershey's bar, you can draw lines on it. But a soda, if soda's got 7 or 8 or 20 servings in it, a lot of them have 20, you can't really demark that well. Or the ice cream bars, or the cotton candies, or the granola mix, and that kind of thing. So those are challenges. So with these higher potencies, we've seen tragedies happen. Levy Tombo-Pongi was a foreign exchange student from the Republic of Congo, attending university in Wyoming. Came to Colorado Springs on spring break with his friends. His friends got some edibles. He was only 19. He didn't go in the store. So he did not hear the instructions of the bud tender in the shop, who told him that a sixth of a cookie was a serving. He ate a cookie. We know at least one cookie. And that's as far as I'll go, because I don't know. I've heard people say two or three. I read the toxicology report from the CDC, and I only found that he ate one cookie. He was marijuana naive. He did not have any experience with marijuana. And so he had a psychotic break. He actually, I'm going to go through this really quickly, but he leapt out of the hotel window several stories to his death. The CDC, in a 250-panel talk screen, ruled it the first death related to marijuana. And this is one of those outcomes of death related to marijuana intoxication. That's something new. We've never seen that before. So that shocked us. We had the next year a very similar story with Luke Goodman, which I'm not going to get into. These are products that we've never seen before. And actually, these derivatives are written into the Massachusetts bill to define cannabis. Ours did not. We didn't know about those. But yours includes concentrates and extracts. So we have THC cartridges that go into the e-cigarettes or vape pens. This Puffit was reviewed by the cannabis as a public discreet use. And you don't smell the cannabis in the same way that you do a typical marijuana cigarette. So it's a challenge, and it's a challenge in the workplace, it's a challenge in schools, because kids are really fond of these things. The BHOs, butane hash oil, and butane hash extractions are another challenge. These are actually 40% of the market right now. So we have edibles at 60%, BHOs, concentrates are 40% of the market. And so what does this look like? They go by different names: dabs, wax, butter, shatter, a lot of different things. But anyway, they're extracted with butane or another chemical solvent. They're superheated. I was in a presentation by the Colorado Department of Public Health, and a demonstration was given, and the marijuana industry that was explaining what these are and how they work and how they're extracted explained that one hit of dabs is equal to 26 hits of a traditional joint. So super potent. We have products now that are, we know for sure 90%, that those have been lab tested. We have a couple of folks in the industry who are claiming that they have 95 and 100% products, but I haven't seen confirmation of that. Another problem we've had is butane hash oil lab explosions, because the process is very tenuous. So we've seen an increase in those. We've seen an increase in commercialization. Here's billboards. Here are ads in newspapers. Every ad you see is for a coupon, a discount, buy one, get one free, a sale or something or other. Here's one of my favorite ones, is that you get a free eighth or edible of choice with an appliance repair. I was like, okay, whatever. My community has two gas and grass stations. That's something we didn't expect. We didn't expect vending machines. Those are popular in the ski community, so those exist. I just want to say our black market has not been eliminated at all. We've got interdictions and seizures throughout the nation. Those are increasing. We have vape lounges, which are also written into your law, which for Colorado was unintended. Craigslist is called the gray market. 35,000 hits. For just my community alone, and our community opted out of retail. So how this works is someone, you can give away up to an ounce for free. Your law allows that as well. So we have people who are like, I'll drive out your eighth or your half or whatever, and you just donate to my gas. And why I mention that is because it undercuts the tax scheme. So it's called the gray market or the black market, because you don't pay the tax rate on that. That's a freebie. So that's a challenge on the tax money. The home grows cannot be regulated. So we're having a lot of problems with those. I'm just going to skip through there. You heard crime is down. Some nonviolent crimes have gone down, but violent crimes have gone up. I can give you these stats if you like. We're going to eliminate the black market for kids. We're not going to get it from drug dealers anymore. So they're not going to be able to get access. Most of them say, I got it from a friend who obtained it legally. Our youth use is up. And I want to stop here for a second and give you a little data to just make a little bit more sense. Here you can see by SAMHSA, National Survey of Drug Use and Health, we're number one in the nation. So you heard about the Healthy Kids Colorado survey, and youth use is down in Colorado. That went out internationally. I have people from Australia emailing it to me and going, hey, what about this? So Healthy Kids Colorado survey was done in-state. It's a voluntary survey in our schools. Four of the largest school districts in the state did not participate, will not participate again this year. Our kids are over-surveyed, and this one being voluntary and not mandatory like the national surveys are, school district said no thank you. So what that means, when you take out the four largest school districts in Colorado, and they're along the I-25 corridor, which is our heaviest populated areas, and three of those areas being areas that opted into retail sales, you take out the majority of the populace of kids in the state. So you're basically surveying the kids that live in the ranch areas and Grand Junction, which is also a ranch community, it's just larger. But you're taking out the largest school districts in the entire state. And what we saw in the survey is that 8th grade uses up, 9th grade uses up, 10th grade uses up, but it drops in 11th and 12th grade. So they amalgamated that data together and said it remained flat, therefore it didn't go up. Okay, well, if 8th grade uses up, that's a bad thing. 9th grade uses up, 10th grade uses up. What happens to the juniors and seniors? They're dropping out. And so the kids who are there to survey are the kids who have either evened out or don't have a problem to begin with. And we were going down on our, this is suspensions and expulsions, I'm sorry, our dropout rate. We were going down in our dropout rate. We were working on that because we had atrocious dropout rates several years ago, and so we've been working really hard. We were getting it down, now it's going back up. You've heard about the use, having trouble with those middle school kids and the vape pens. Marketing to children is a concern. Here's a store that painted Cookie Monster on the side. He's got little marijuana leaves in his chocolate chip cookies. I don't know if you can see it very clearly from where you are, but on the right side of that building, does anybody recognize those cookies? Those are Girl Scout cookies, three brands. Thin Mints and what the other ones are called, the coconut things and the peanut butter cookies. So, you know, kids see that and it just, it sends them a message. We're having problems with ingestions among toddlers, with emergency room visits. We're having problems with kids who complete suicide, and having marijuana on board is now greater than alcohol. That's a problem for our kids. Advertising that's kid-friendly. Over here we have a 20% off everything with your student ID. Santa Claus is selling pot. He's got little marijuana buds flowing out of his pack. And the thing about this, they want you to understand that, you know, I was putting this presentation together, and my grandson was visiting at the time. He was three. And he's running through the house, and he stops, and he looks at my computer, and he goes, "Grandma, what's that Santa Claus doing?" You know, so what did he see? He didn't know what the buds were in the back of the pack, but he knows Santa Claus. Santa Claus. And so as he gets older and Santa Claus is like, yeah, you know, that sends him a message. I don't want to spend a lot of time on regulate like alcohol because we don't have time, but one thing that I absolutely want you to know is that being in drug and alcohol testing, being a certified breath alcohol technician, an evidentiary breath alcohol trainer, and also on two DUI task forces in Colorado, I can tell you we do not have a way to measure impairment. We do not have an impairment standard for marijuana. We do not have a breath alcohol test for marijuana. What is being invented is a saliva capture instrument, because marijuana doesn't come out of the breath, it comes out in saliva. And right now, saliva is not evidentiary in court. We have to create that system. So we're not close to that. And it's a problem. DUI is a problem in Colorado. We have not solved it. Our marijuana-related deaths are increasing every single year in our state. So that is a problem. And then let me just hit the tax revenue and I'll be done. We've had triple the rate of positive THC drug tests in the workplace. We've got problems with pre-employment tests, whatever. Okay, so our tax. 2015 was the best tax year we had. We were initially promised on our committee $160 million per year out of the gate. The first year, I think we hit $40 million, or maybe it was $38. And we've gone up each year. This was our best year, the total $104 million. First 40 is supposed to go to schools. it's not quite working out that way, but what does that look like in a whole state budget? And by the way, your tax rate is a half of ours. Less than 0.7% of our entire state budget in income. But one of the things that we're not talking about is the cost. So if you just take those ER visits, only the marijuana-related ER visits, and the ones I gave you were from one hospital system, not the whole state. And we take the average cost of an emergency room visit, and we put a price to that. Just in 2014 only, that's $22.5 million. But let's talk about those marijuana-related fatalities on the road. One roadside fatality, according to the National Highway Transportation Safety Administration, is 1.4 million to adjudicate that. If we take only those last 3 years of marijuana-related fatalities only, 13, 14, and 15, and we put that number to it, we're in the hole $2.12 billion. I'm sorry, but $115 million a year is not going to cover that, and we are not calculating the costs. So those are things we just need to think about, we need to be aware of. This is about commercialization, and it's about some folks who want to make some money, and you know, that's for you guys to decide in your state. That's what we're seeing in Colorado, and so I'll be happy to answer your questions afterward, and I'll be tech guy for the next person.
So as Stan introduced me, I'm John Seibeck. I am not Senator Lewis. Jason Lewis is a senator from the eastern part of the state who couldn't make it tonight. Jason Lewis is one of eight members of a special commission appointed by the Senate to deal with this issue. And so I'm fortunate to have Jason's slides, and we'll use them going forward. There were eight members on this task force. Our Senate President, our Senator Stan Rosenberg appointed the members. They went to Colorado. Seven of the eight left in favor, in support of legalization of marijuana, and all eight came back in opposition. Part of that, in large part, due to some of the things we heard from both Ruth and Joe. And so what I want to do is talk about some of the issues that he presented and give you a sense of where things are. So the issue is one of context really does matter. You know, when we look at Massachusetts, marijuana is already decriminalized. I think one of the first communities that did this was, I think it was Ann Arbor, Michigan, back in the mid to late 60s in terms of decriminalization of marijuana. And then it was a civil fine and wasn't in jail time. So we decriminalized it in 2008. People aren't being arrested, they're not being jailed, they don't get a criminal record for possession usage amounts, relatively small amounts. And medical marijuana was passed in 2012. I voted in support of it. I do support it, and I think quite frankly and quite candidly, I think that we really didn't do the best job of legalization of marijuana as well. I can tell you there are loopholes. Somebody said there are holes that you could drive a truck through. One person said that and gave an example that individual goes to see physicians that I need medical marijuana, and why do you need it? I need it for my anxiety. Why do you have anxiety? Because I can't buy marijuana. And technically that really would fit. And there are individuals who could in fact prescribe under those circumstances. All right, I don't want to spend a lot of time on the data because you saw it. But what we saw certainly with Ruth beginning is there are fewer youth who think that marijuana is harmful. And then more youth who are using it daily. And so the issue really becomes one of what are we doing? Are we opening Pandora's box? That's part of why the Senate President sent this group of individuals to Colorado saying, all right, what's happening here? What really is going on as opposed to starting from scratch? So Ruth also talked about THC being much stronger. So it's really kind of interesting that there are, I don't know, 135 various compounds. So we look at THC as the one that people were commenting on. I thought about this driving here, sort of like that old commercial, you know, that, you know, this is not your father's Oldsmobile. This is not your father's marijuana. So you look at THC levels that are considerably higher. So if we look at why we want to use marijuana, So if I'm looking at marijuana for medical purposes, you got a couple of choices. So if I look at CBD, which is cannabidiol, it's interesting. That has the effect that you want to achieve in medical marijuana. So it provides you the opportunity to get an analgesic effect, an antidepressant, a neuroprotectant. Basically, it gives you what you want in terms of the medical purposes without getting high and without getting stoned. And the THC levels that really were the attractiveness in terms of getting the buzz that everybody talked about. So if we look over a period of time, THC has gotten stronger. Are we surprised? We shouldn't be. Let's look at the potency of heroin and how heroin has changed from the 60s to today. Let's look at fentanyl and other additives that are there. So we're not looking at the same situation. We're not comparing apples and apples if you look at marijuana in the 1960s and marijuana today. And the other thing is certainly the profit model. So almost 50% of the sales in Colorado come from edibles and concentrates. And that's a scary phenomenon. It wasn't unusual. I guess it was somewhat unusual, but it wasn't unheard of for parents to wind up taking their kids into the emergency room or seeing a physician in the 50s and 60s because the child consumed chocolates. But the child didn't consume chocolates. The child consumed an entire package of X-Lax. And they saw something that was chocolate and thought, okay, this is chocolate. This is candy. I can eat this. Okay, we're in a similar situation today. It gets even worse and really problematic when you start looking at the marketing. And again, I don't want to spend a lot of time. Joe did a great job with some of the things that we saw in Colorado. They're probably the best examples. She talked about this as well. It's kind of hard to believe that there are over 700, there are more marijuana shops than Starbucks and McDonald's. Now, I understand. I understand the individual who owns that shop or is running that shop is looking to make a profit. But the reality is, what are we doing in terms of that society? And so let's look at it, not from this grant, this perspective, let's look at it from this perspective. So look at this map. And what you're seeing is every one of those is a marijuana center, marijuana shop. So we think that there, you know, there are far too many package stores. I mean, for me as a legislator, one of the things we have to deal with is an over-quota liquor licenses. There are too many package stores. There are more package stores, more restaurants. Everyone wants liquor licenses. Let's look at what we're looking at realistically just in the city of Denver. We saw this graph as well in terms of the impact on Colorado teens and how Colorado has risen to become the number one state in the nation for teen marijuana use. Fatal road crashes. You saw some dramatic examples, but here are the numbers. So it's doubling after the state legalizes it. And we heard that there is no way to assess impairment as there is with alcohol. So part of my problem is that I don't believe that making policy by referendum is the right way to go. So let's stop. Let's not even talk about marijuana for a couple of minutes. A couple of years ago, we had a ballot question called the right to repair. Very simple ballot question. It said it allowed you to go to any repair shop to have your car repaired, that you didn't have to go to the dealer. Makes a lot of sense. You buy a car from a dealer, once I pay for the car, I should be able to get my car fixed anywhere that I want. And the issue became one of the proprietary software in particular to diagnose and repair that car. Massachusetts legislature passed a bill prior to the last election that actually clarified that. And there was a referendum question. Last term, I chaired the Joint Committee on Consumer Protection and Professional Licensure, and I had the distinct honor and privilege of trying to reconcile a law that already passed and a ballot question that was confusing, inconsistent, and problematic. And it took us approximately a year to try to do that. All right, today, we have early voting. I voted today. Okay, and many of you, if you haven't voted yet, have gotten your little red booklet in terms of ballot questions. So if you haven't, pull that booklet out again and see exactly what that ballot question of marijuana says to you. Does it say anything about impaired driving? Does it say anything about the vending machine use? Does it say anything about some of these other ambiguities? No, it does not. Let's shift gears for 1 second. Question 2, charter schools. Now that's an interesting one. So if question two passes, question two says we're going to remove the cap on charter schools, which will allow 12 charter schools per year forever and ever in the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. The interesting thing is right now we have 78 charter schools in Massachusetts. We already have a cap of 120. So we are 32, my math is right, 32 schools below the cap. But we're being asked 50, so thank you. Thanks. I just want to see if you're awake. So we are 52 below the cap. Yeah, I'm hung on 32 because I'm thinking 3 years. So what the proponents could do is actually, under the current law, the current system, add 12 charter schools a year for the next 3 years, or 3.5 years, and work with the opponents on the ballot question to come with a more fair and equitable funding formula. But they're not doing that. So the problem with ballot questions and legislating by referendum is a problem, because it doesn't solve all the issues. There are other questions, and I know we've heard people say, well, geez, and we've tried to get here. We've tried to get here before, and you as a legislature, and you as an individual legislator, haven't addressed this issue. We're filing bills, they're not going anywhere. So, well, you know, this is our only hope. Well, part of why it's not going anywhere is the answer to some of these other questions. So, our ballot question sets no limit on potency. We've heard that as a concern. Specifically authorizes edibles. So the things that we heard about, the gummy bears and all the other things, are permissible. It limits a municipality's ability to limit the nature and presence of marijuana in their communities. So unless a community specifically takes a vote and says, we don't want to have marijuana in our community, this will allow, if a city has 25 package stores, well, large cities certainly do, they must automatically allow 5 marijuana retail establishments unless they explicitly vote not to do that. So this says 20, you can look at 20% of the package stores, and that's the number of marijuana shops you're going to have in a community. Did you realize that? Was that part of that little red booklet? I don't think so. It also says that any agreement that exists right now between a municipality and a medical marijuana treatment center can't prevent them from selling recreational marijuana. So communities that took the step to say, okay, I will have a medical marijuana facility in my community, I think that's fine, I believe in that, now will not be permitted necessarily to say, oh no, no recreational marijuana. So the question we're looking at bars communities from restricting home grows. It guarantees preferential licensing to those medical marijuana, those dispensaries that are already there. It sets a very low tax rate. It's very, very interesting. So right now, we've got splits. So our Senate president came out and said he supports question four. The speaker's opposed to it. The governor's opposed to it. But all three of them are united in saying, this tax rate is screwed up. This tax rate has got to be addressed. So there's a problem before we even get to the ballot question, before we even see it, there's an inherent recognition saying, this isn't going to work. So if your design and the purpose of this, and we've also heard this for years and years and years, that's the way we're going to balance our budget. If there's been a deficit, if we legalize marijuana, and I've heard this from this community and certain people in this community for years, we legalize marijuana, that will solve our budget problems. I've seen bills filed that said, okay, we're going to do a different tax rate based on potency. I mean, it's just so convoluted. And from my perspective, why do we want to do this at this point in time? And then you start looking at one other issue. Let's look at it from a social perspective. Looks like one piece of data you didn't see from Colorado. And that's the fact that there's a disparity in marijuana arrests between whites and blacks and Latino adults. So if I look at it, whites, it's gone down 8%, or 29% increase for Hispanics, and 58% for African Americans. Here's the tax issue. You don't have to rebuild, but that's really what you're talking about. And finally, well, you would think with that map and showing the number of facilities that are in Colorado, there really isn't much of an issue. But we heard about Craigslist, we heard about the gray market. Certainly, black market is happening. Black market is alive and well and continuing to thrive in Colorado. So my concern at this point is we're going to take a leap off this cliff, and we won't be able to come back and turn back. And there are situations where Massachusetts always is at the forefront in terms of progressive legislation and things that make sense for this country and for our people. But this is one time we need to look at the experiences of Colorado. Let's look at Washington. Even if you support this, and you're a supporter of legalization of marijuana, do you support impaired driving? And if not, how do you suspect or submit that we will solve that problem? So until we address those issues and concerns, we should not take that leap off the cliff. And that's why we have not passed this legislation today. And that's why I think you should vote no, because there are too many questions and not enough answers. Thank you.
Dave Sullivan, the district attorney for Hampshire and Franklin and the town of Athol. One of our goals as a district attorney's office is to really create and build upon safe and healthy communities. So when we ask about legalization of marijuana, let's just ask one question. Will it make our communities healthier? So I want to be clear, as I have been with, as I think with the other panels here tonight, is that I was a defense attorney for 16 years, and I became district attorney in 2010 before the decriminalization. I favored decriminalization because I just didn't feel that anybody should be strapped with the stigma of a conviction, be deprived of federal financial aid, be impaired in employment. So I favor that decriminalization, hoping that it would not further marijuana use with youth. I was wrong. I wasn't wrong about the decriminalization, but it did not reduce youth use. That meant those 25 and below, and teen use. I favored medical marijuana for debilitating illnesses, because I felt that anybody who had cancer or a serious disease that could be helped by cannabis had a right to that substance without feeling they were a criminal. And I'm very pleased with the minority of people who have received that treatment. But did it reduce teen and youth use? No. I've had an opportunity, which I hope every citizen has over the next 2 weeks, or maybe you've done the research before, to really learn the facts and some of the serious issues with legalization of marijuana in our communities. I have the honor to advocate for the most vulnerable members of society, the disabled, elders, and youth, and children. And that's why I'm here today. I'm here as an advocate for youth and teen brain development, and giving kids that opportunity. Will this legalization reduce teen and youth use? We've seen all the stats. It's clear it will not. I want you to read the Red Book or read a synopsis and realize that the work that Ruth Pote does in addiction science, addiction is a real issue. We didn't know about this, just the way we didn't know about global warming. But now we know about addiction science. We know the dynamic of it. Age of first use, genetics, and childhood trauma. Those are the three major factors that really create that situation. Do we want a society that feels they have to get high and stoned to live a full and productive life? Do we want that? Do we want the advertising that we saw for Colorado? We want those things, because it's going to be dictated by the adults in this room and elsewhere. And I consider adults 18 and over. Maybe the brain isn't fully developed, and we know that. I didn't know much about addiction science until I had the opportunity to meet and to listen to Ruth Potee. I would love every citizen to vote yes or no based upon science, based upon what was presented here today and elsewhere. The science is clear. That brain, that teen brain that develops between the age of 12 and 24 at a very rapid rate, all the pruning and everything else, marijuana will not help that brain develop. And many of you in this room who may advocate for legalization, your brains are developed, okay? You can be an advocate, but please advocate for the youngest members of society. I want you to picture a bell curve. And I want you to picture that bell curve, and I want to give you a statistic from our Department of Public Health. The mean use of marijuana of age in this state is 12.8 years of first use. That means those that are 9, 10, 11 have used, and all the way up. So 12.8 years. That's fourth, fifth, sixth grades, okay? It's pretty serious stuff with me. And when did we accept that our kids at the age of 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, all the way up to 18, in that rate, I think if you notice, Massachusetts, I think seventh on the list. It's nothing to be proud of. We really need to get a grip on addiction in our society. And I'm not just talking about marijuana. I'm talking about alcohol, nicotine, pills. That's where we got this opioid crisis. But it comes down to these wonderful courses that we are now bringing to schools. Life skills, for example, teaches kids about self-esteem and teaches them how to cope with stress without drinking, taking a pill, or using marijuana. I'm not singling out marijuana. I know the devastation of alcohol. And I know the devastation of marijuana and opioids as well. The Pandora's box is open. I would say at a rate of 25 or 30% of marijuana use, I think that's pretty serious. I grew up on the south side of a community in Eastern Mass, Framingham. And what how families supported themselves and lived was they worked at the Denison Manufacturing 12 hours a day, GM, maybe the Edison, maybe the telephone company. It was a thriving, low and middle income, and people could afford homes. But they also didn't get a second chance in life. If you dropped out, you didn't get that second chance. So I want everybody to think, and please raise your hand when I ask you this. There were 1,500 treatment admissions in 2013, and it's gone up for teens. This is between the age of 12 and 18 in Massachusetts. 1,500 treatment. That represents 55% of all the substance abuse admissions. That means alcohol, opioids. Marijuana is the leading cause of treatment admissions for those 12 to 18. Think of how much that costs. Think of how much that costs. There's not a single nickel in this referendum, this ballot initiative, I should say, that dedicates one nickel to prevention, intervention, treatment, or recovery. This was written like big marijuana. They don't care. It's about greed over public health. I hope that it doesn't pass for one reason. We gotta figure out as a society before we make this even more accessible and available to you. But that bill that I was talking about, it starts at 12, 10, and it goes up and it peaks at 25, and it goes down from there. Do we all agree that that's about 25 is what people reduce their use? So half of the use in Massachusetts and America is from the ages of 10 to 25. The proponents of this say it's a $1.2 billion business. It's probably more because we will be the central spot in New England. Let's not kid ourselves, it's probably closer to $2 billion, right? That means this industry has to target those between the ages of 10 and 20 to make their money. They have to. That's the business model. I went to Eisenberg School of Management at UMass. I know business. I was a business owner. Their market has to be, because they have to get kids hooked the same way Big Tobacco did, Joe Camel and everything else. That's what happens. That's the market. If we just had one simple penalty, if a store sold to an underage individual and we took their license away, that's not written in, is it? There isn't even a penalty for underage possession. Now in Massachusetts, it's underage alcohol. And we use that as a tool. We decriminalize it. We don't give them a criminal record, but we get them into a really good brain course about brain development and about alcohol use and dangers. We really do. And we use that at University of Mass, we have Brain at Risk. We really want to encourage people to live, to learn, and to educate themselves about the dangers of alcohol. There's not a single provision in this initiative that even does that. It's a $100 fine. You know what that is? That's a ticket to ignorance. If you're only paying $100, you aren't doing what you need to do. I don't want to go over all the slides that you've seen tonight, but I really want folks to look into this. Dig deep. And if you have any questions about it, let's wait. Let's wait. Is there a harm? Right now, people can grow their own marijuana for medical purposes, okay? And I won't get into the potency. If you had a ballot initiative, and the ballot initiative said that you were gonna legalize firecrackers, and the firecrackers had 2.5% gunpowder in it, you'd say, that's fine. Let's vote for firecracker. Let's legalize firecrackers. This one doesn't set up a limit on potency. It can go up to 90% unlimited, okay? Now, you're a recreational user. It's not really healthy for a teen brain or for an adult brain to get 80 or 90% THC hit. What I say, when you don't limit potency, you're not legalizing cannabis as it was back in the 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s. You've got a new marijuana. It's a concentrate. Massachusetts, if it was 2.5 or above for 45 years, you know what they classify that as? Hashish. This is really the legalization of marijuana and hashish, and not a single paper has written about it, because the statute says, quite frankly, if it's 2.5 or above, it should be considered hashish. So why haven't we seen a single article that says legalization of marijuana and hashish? That would be the truth, wouldn't it? Under our law. But really, what we want to look at is, do we want to legalize an unlimited amount of potency? We have members here that have had prescriptions for medical marijuana. And that's not something we're going to take away. But when people in the neighborhood of Ward 3, here in Northampton and elsewhere, went to legalize, to accept medical marijuana in their neighborhood, they weren't told that they would get an automatic ticket to recreational marijuana. Is that right? That everybody gets sold a bill of goods for zoning? And now this referendum gives an automatic monopoly.
For all five stores, sir. Five of them.
We're gonna wait for comments until later, okay. Please wait.
So, here's the marketing. Here's 55 to 60% of the market in Colorado and Washington. If this candy and brownies and cookies aren't geared to kids, if they aren't geared to kids in your mind, then vote yes. But I say vote no, because this is what the market's about. We're not talking about adult recreational use. We're talking about the impact of chronic use. The impact of chronic use. Public health policy should be set by learned people like John Sivek and Senator Lewis, by Joe McGuire, and by Ruth Poteet. I'm here as a parent, as a regular citizen. And I've worked hard to try to come on the right side of this issue. And if you have any doubts at all, and you don't think that this will produce a better, healthier society, particularly with teens, I think you know what the answer is. I think we have to vote our conscience. And we should really see with this grand experiment of easy accessibility, easy use, and the good housekeeping seal of approval from society. Because when we legalize things, we say in society,
that is acceptable, the social norm is something that we want. Please look into this. Look into the facts. Look into the evidence. Let's make the right decision on this, not just for today, but for our future of our citizens, and particularly our youth.
Okay, we're going to move now into our audience segment of this. If people have index cards, please hold them up so Lori can collect them. And if people want to speak, if you want to wave your hand and bring the mic to you. I have one question while we're doing that. I have one question that we need to turn into address. We heard Joe say that 4 years after the constitutional amendment was passed in Colorado, there still is no way of sexual impairment driving on the influence of marijuana. How much of a concern is that for you here then?
It's a deep concern that we cannot hold people accountable for impaired driving while under the influence of drugs. That means whether it's opioids or marijuana, we cannot test. We can't do the breathalyzer that we do for alcohol. So when accidents are happening, we can tell if there's marijuana in the system, but we can't tell the level of impairment. It's a serious, serious situation. And we've been promised that there's technology and there's tests coming ahead. They haven't even gotten to the point of reaching that. So we're going to have a long period of time, anywhere from 2 to 10 years before we can develop it. If we can develop it, it's a big promise. But you know, I think those that saw the press conference from Trooper Clardy, who died on the Massachusetts Pike, from his widow, a marijuana card fell out of that person's pocket. Now, I'm not saying that could have been alcohol just the same as marijuana, but let's not be naive to the fact that impaired driving is a serious issue. And because of the potency, remember the potency, that kids in particular are not going to be high for 1 hour. They're going to be high for a lot longer. And that temptation to drive is driven by having to get home, having to get back to school, having to get somewhere. And that not every kid is going to wait the 4 or 5 hours when they are impaired on this very potent marijuana. So I think that's another significant reason why we should wait. Let's get the technology so we can hold people accountable for injuring and killing people. We can do that with alcohol. Let's wait for marijuana to be tested.
Thank you, and thanks to all the panelists. Okay, now a question from the audience.
We wanted to keep it under a minute. That's a comment or a question.
Yeah. Right there, please.
Thanks. I just want to thank all the presenters for coming out tonight for a good presentation. My name is Greg Rowland. I live in East Hampton. I am a father of three, and I have been a volunteer for the No on 4 campaign. I just want to let everybody here this evening know that there are lawn signs in the back of the room for the No on 4, and if anyone is interested, feel free to pick one up, or if you know somebody else who would like a lawn sign, you should feel free to grab one. That's why they're there. So, but I appreciate all the presentations. Thank you.
Do you want to ask a question?
No, I'll pass it on.
Okay.
Just an ad.
Hello. So I think this is a fact. I'm pretty sure. I think this is something that a lot of people think. Kids are not going to stop smoking cannabis. Even if it gets low enough, it's not going to take 10 years, 20 years. It's going to take a while. So my question is, would you rather have me, my little brother, or your children going to a drug dealer who also sells cocaine, MDMA, heroin, instead of having someone responsible and, you know, able to legally buy cannabis. Instead of having that person go and pay a federal tax for their cannabis so that they can enjoy it safely. Because people are still going to smoke it regardless of what age they are. So I see it as a sort of thing. Would you rather have them buy it illegally from unsafe sources or from someone who knows what they're doing, and that money can go to a better cause. So that's...
Who did you want to answer that question?
I'll take anyone.
You'll take anyone, okay?
There's a couple of flaws in the question, because first of all, it will still be illegal for kids under 21 to purchase. So kids can't purchase. So when you say we're going to keep kids away from the drug dealers, they can't purchase this way. So, you know, to say that they'll go to someone who makes sure that it's safe, first of all, there aren't any standards for safety of the product. That's why we're having these extremely high potencies. So even if they went to the retail store, they're getting potencies, but they can't purchase in the stores anyway. So they're getting it from their friends and family and whatnot. And as a mom of a kid who used pot, and as the aunt of a niece who used the concentrates, their stuff that they got from friends who had medical cards, or, you know, they got it from people who obtained it legally. My niece got a hold of some concentrate that was laced with cocaine. My son got a hold of some pot that was laced with methamphetamine. And that came from medical dispensaries. So that's not the solution. I understand what you're going for there, but it's just it's a false dichotomy, unfortunately, and this doesn't solve that issue.
And then I also had a follow-up about home grows, because at a previous forum, people asked about, or there was touting of, you won't be able to access marijuana unless you have an ID, there's a regulatory system, but that absolutely doesn't apply for home growth, because you just give weed away, there's no one asking for ID, there's no age limit. So that's just something to think about, home grows and accessibility.
Okay, I'm going to read a question from the audience. This is for anyone on the panel. If question four, will legalize marijuana only for people 21 and older, why is there so much focus on teenagers?
The issue is because one of the campaign promises is keep it out of the hands of kids, but the reality is that's not what's happening. So that's why there's a focus on the kids, because I teach about marijuana impaired driving to our high school students every fall for our Drive Smart program. And when I go into auditoriums or classrooms, doesn't matter, 8th through 12th grade, and I ask them what legal weed means, they say it means safe. And I ask them, did you hear that this is for 21 and older? And they look at me like they have no idea what I'm talking about, because as the young man said, well, they still get access to alcohol. So regulating alcohol doesn't keep it out of their hands. Why would regulating marijuana keep it out of their hands? So it's just that that's not how it's going to go down, and people are concerned about what will happen to you.
I just want to respond a little bit to it. And that is actually alcohol use among teenagers under the age of 21 and 24 has actually never been lower. When you look at the stats on nicotine, which is what I started with, and then on alcohol, it's never been lower. And we've had statistically significant drops on alcohol use in our society since the 1970s. It keeps dropping and dropping. Why is that? Because we really do regulate it hard. And in fact, you know, we have people that walk into every liquor store every week in Massachusetts and try to buy underage. You know who loses their license? Those liquor stores. We pull their license instantly. You will go to jail if you buy alcohol for somebody underage. I will go to jail if I'm serving in my house. Like, it is a problem, and we have, as a society, said that's the problem. Now, what's something that is, because I've made it clear to you, I think alcohol is a terrible drug in society. All day long, I take care of people who are struggling with a terrible alcohol use disorder. Many of us have a healthy relationship to alcohol. And a whole chunk of people, 10 to 16 to 17%, are actually struggling. I was launching into something on this. The worry that I have is as alcohol is dropped, it is a stronger sense that teenagers have that it can be a harmful drug. And what we started with is the sense that many of our teenagers have that this is all good, it's all healthy, it's fine. Wright County, nobody's going to go to a drug dealer and buy their marijuana. It's grown in their backyard. And my teenagers at my high school, that's where it comes from. So the access is going to be there. There's no doubt in my mind that they will be still continuing its use. But the access to gummy bears and candies and things that are 60%, 90% THC is
one of the ways in which looking at this ballot feels so disturbing. We're not going to change the rates of teenage use currently. We're only going to increase it with this ballot measure, though. That's what I'll say.
And I need to tell the panelists that for television purposes, we need you to come to the mic if you might respond. Okay,
bring your
audience.
Hello. My background is in school adjustment counseling. I'm a licensed school adjustment counselor. I've worked at every level. My question is for Mr. Sullivan and Senator Lewis. How will preventative efforts change if question four is passed? And if question four is passed, how will these preventative efforts be funded? Thank you.
The question was about prevention efforts. We're going to have to step up. But we're going to have to pay it out of our pockets. There's very little money. That 3.75% is not targeted toward, not a nickel toward prevention. And let me ask you, as a school adjustment, what's the most substantial drug abuse creating the most impairment dropouts in your school?
Marijuana.
The answer is marijuana. And we're not going to see that decrease. We're going to see it increase. We really need to step up with prevention, and again, really good prevention programs start in the second, third, fourth grade before kids are introduced. And I'm talking about prevention all the way down. I mean, from, you know, any kind of thing from, you know, cyber safety to any kind of substance abuse. And, you know, I think Representative Seibeck can address some of the funding issues. We're really strapped. Our budget is really strapped, and we don't have a lot of extra money to pay for prevention intervention the way that we'd like to. So I'll let the Representative Seibeck address some of the funding issues.
You know, we should have learned our lesson from tobacco. So we get the tobacco settlement, and as soon as we did, if you watch what happened in Massachusetts and other states, but just staying in Massachusetts, as soon as the tobacco dollars came in, this tobacco settlement, and we started using smoking prevention, smoking cessation for kids, we saw the frequency of youth tobacco use drop precipitously. Then when things get bad, we stop using that tobacco money for that purpose and use it for other things. And all of a sudden, youth smoking went back up. I mean, so clearly the example we've seen over the last 20 years relative to tobacco use demonstrates how we've got to stay on top of it in terms of prevention. The problem we have right now is we don't have enough money and we're not focusing enough on treatment. So whether it's marijuana, whether it's opioids, whether it's alcohol, particularly when I'm looking at youth. So if you have a child who needs treatment today, if you're lucky, you may be able to get the person into Providence Hospital, some local place. If not, that person may be sent halfway across the state, if you're lucky to get a bed. And so we've got to focus on prevention. We have another issue in terms of focusing on treatment, and we just simply have an inadequate number of beds and adequate treatment services for kids.
John, the next question I'm going to read is for you, so you might as well stay right here. I'll take you a trip back. This question is for Representative Seibeck. What is the legislature going to do if question four passes to ensure that youth are protected from access to marijuana?
You know, this, being a legislator is kind of a fun, it's a fun job. And every time there's a referendum question, it's, you know, there are individuals saying, you know, you didn't do what the people wanted. Proposition 2.5, the various things. You tried to do an end around. And so what we're going to have to wind up doing is address the issue in its entirety. I said, this ballot question is answering parts of it, but not in its entirety. So as I said earlier, we've already heard from the Speaker, the Governor, and the Senate President saying taxes are totally inadequate. So a commitment from the big three is that tax rate's going to increase immediately. But I think there are going to have to be other issues looking specifically. What I suspect would happen is the governor will appoint a task force immediately, this bill passes, perhaps before the end of the year. If it passes in 2 weeks, the governor says, okay, let's establish a task force to look at implementation and start working on it now and not wait for the legislature to come back in January to start to address it. But we've got to get on it and get on it immediately.
Okay. Yes.
Yeah, hi. Derek, I was a couple of weeks ago, we were in Greenfield and there was a panel discussion and it actually had two people pro and two con. Having four people con is sort of a little odd for a panel. And as a, you know, there wasn't any debate. And throughout the whole time, I was thinking, you know, I want to challenge that, I want to challenge that. And I guess I can only challenge one thing, so that would be my question. Mr. Seibeck, when you were going through your list of problems, one of the things you said was the lack of local control over the stores. And, you know, it's very clear in the bill that the local towns have control, and they can have a vote. You know, and you acknowledge that. What's wrong with voting on it?
Well, there's nothing wrong with voting on it, and participatory democracy is fine. So there is some room, certainly, but there are other issues that simply aren't being addressed and won't be addressed either by the voters on November 8th or on the voters in Northampton or South Hadley or any of the community as they move forward. There are a number of questions that still aren't being addressed at all by this ballot question.
Thanks, Terry. And you've been a great advocate for this particular referendum, although I'm opposed to it.
Well, I mean, if I could dispute that,
I'm
a great advocate for this particular thing, but I'm supporting.
Okay, that's right. Massachusetts has a tradition of home rule. And the name of this initiative is Regulate and Tax Marijuana Like Alcohol. Just the opposite. For over 100 years in Massachusetts, communities had to vote to accept alcohol. We've turned this on the head. We all know when you have to opt out, it takes money to run a campaign, a lot of organization. They could have written this that you had to opt in, but they didn't. They intentionally gave a title that it's just going to be like alcohol to regulate and tax, just the opposite. It's forcing every citizen to go and organize that doesn't want their community to pay the money to organize. Why don't we just have an opt-in so then you can vote as communities? And I'll let you know one thing. The second biggest community in Colorado, they're opting out. They're taking a vote to opt out. That's full up. So we are losing home rule. If anybody cares about their community, that you don't want marijuana in your community, you're going to have to organize again. So you might be organizing today, but you're going to have to organize as soon as any referendum's passed on this. And you know, quite frankly, I think we should have kept our Massachusetts tradition the same as alcohol. If it passes, people should have had to opt in, not opt out. And that's my opinion on home rule. Home rule's important, and anybody who really cares about home rule should be offended by this initiative.
All right, the next question is not directed at any particular panelist, but I think Ruth is best suited to answer it. And the question is, what percentage of marijuana addiction is physical versus psychological?
So the whole mind-body split that Kant brought to us is a crazy split. I think we can all acknowledge that. Most of our diseases are really completely connected between the brain and the body, so I'm not going to say there is any physiologic or psychologic difference. I mean, all addiction happens in the brain. I think the question is really, can people have physiologic withdrawal from marijuana? And the answer, of course you can. And for those people who smoke marijuana for a long time and then tried to quit, it's actually a tricky drug to get off of. For my people I take care of who have to be off of marijuana because they're in drug court or because they're going to violate probation, they will tell you how much they struggle with stopping. So the number one symptom that people describe is really extreme anxiety and agitation, and it lasts for months at times. And is that as bad as withdrawing from a whole lot of heroin? Probably not, but I mean, who am I to judge? It all feels bad. Withdrawal of any sort, withdrawal from alcohol can be a terrifying thing too. So all addiction happens deep in the brain, and you know, not all of us get addicted to the drug, but certainly a certain percent of us will, and the withdrawal is really tricky. There's no medicine out there that helps with the withdrawal symptoms. I mean, you can help people with the anxiety, I guess, a little bit, but for those of us who've done treatment of teenagers who are addicted to marijuana, it's just sort of like keep them away from the drug, help provide them some support for whether they have some baseline anxiety or other mental health issue, help them sleep.
Like, I look at my own kids who have sleeping issues or anxiety. The last thing I need them to do is think, oh, I'm going to start using pot because it's going to make me better. You know what I need my kids to be doing? I need them to be exercising. If they're anxious, I need them to be in therapy. I need them to do sort of mindfulness-based stress reduction. If there's a history of trauma, I need to get really good trauma-informed treatment. I need to be throwing at these kids really good quality treatment. I am a prescriber, but I tell you, I'm not about the drugs. Anybody who's a patient of mine, I'm like, girlfriend, you're depressed. Let's get you moving. Let's get you into therapy. Let's get you really good treatment to make your brain better. It's not just about giving people another substance for their brain all the time. We are a country of there is a pill for every ill. What is wrong with us? Right? We can get a hell of a lot healthier by just changing our behavior. So I'm not going to say there's a separation between those two things. Addiction is addiction. It has physiologic consequences, but it all happens in the brain.
Question in the back.
I have a comment and a question. The first comment is that sort of like the take home that I'm getting from this is that even if number four passes, that rather than sort of disband the no on four, it seems as if the next thing that has to happen is lobbying for regulation immediately. The question I have is probably mostly to Dr. Poti, is I'm curious, you know, given that there's not enough treatment beds and there's not enough access to methadone, et cetera, do you have a sense of like whether or not folks who are addicted to opiates are switching or using marijuana to mitigate some of their withdrawal symptoms?
Everyone who struggled with the heroin problem in this room, but the heroin withdrawal is really horrible. People are incredibly sick. It doesn't kill you, but boy, you wish you were dead some days. So marijuana does not seem to help much with that. It just doesn't. Like, that's out of the scope of most marijuana. I don't know, maybe I should be using hashish oil in my treatment center. Maybe I'll change up my game a little bit, but I don't think it's going to work that well. So Valley Medical Group, which is where I work, that's here in town, right? I work at the one in Greenfield, but we sat down as a group. Bay State Health Center said we will certify nobody for medical marijuana as a policy. That's what they did. And we said, that's not the way we work at Valley Medical Group. We look at the science, we look at the evidence behind things, and we make a decision as a group about what we're going to do. And so what we did at Valley is we went through all the data we could find and looked at all the reasons you could certify somebody for marijuana in the state of Massachusetts and said, you know, we find good evidence behind four or five medical conditions. And if you meet those four or five medical conditions, it goes to a little committee, and then we say, sure, you can have your medical marijuana card. We said there was an asterisk on the final condition, which is that if you have chronic pain and you're on opiates, and we could reduce your opiates and replace it with marijuana, we're in, because we think marijuana is a hell of a lot less harmful than opiates. That's what we said. So the vast majority of our certification is trying to reduce people's opiate use for chronic pain. And you know what we found in our year of doing this? We have not reduced a single bit, not a milligram of people's opiate use. It just hasn't worked. It just hasn't worked. We want it to work. We want people to be down, down, down. And if they need a little marijuana to do that, I'm in. It just, we haven't seen it. So meaning that it is not an equivalent exchange. We just don't see it work that way. Now, for those of us who develop an addiction to an opiate for a thousand reasons, right? A history of childhood trauma, genetics, early use. What we find in Colorado is that there is a decreased rate of addiction to opiates, right? That's what we sort of have seen, and Joe may correct me on this, but the rates in the last 3 years of developing addiction to opiates has been supplanted by developing an overuse syndrome or an addiction to marijuana. So I've replaced one addiction with another addiction. If I could go back 20 years and make everybody I'm treating today for their heroin addiction addicted to marijuana, would that be easier or better? I don't know. I just feel, again, like we're creating some generations of people who are not fully actualized human beings. So for me, supplanting one addiction with another is not so beneficial. And it's so the use of marijuana for either alcohol treatment or heroin addiction or cocaine, any of it, it's never been shown to work. They use marijuana already. They come to me. Everybody has THC positive urines and cocaine and, as of yesterday, angel dust and heroin. It's all mixed together. So the marijuana is being used actively already, and it doesn't seem to be helping their heroin problem. Thank you for asking that question.
The only thing I know for sure on the, I'm not going to speak to the addiction, but I'll say on the use. National Survey of Drug Use and Health just said recently that Colorado now has highest in the nation of opioids, of marijuana, of cocaine, and alcohol. So we haven't dropped anything across the board. In fact, we thought our alcohol use would go down with legalization. Our alcohol use has gone up. That was a surprise. That was unexpected. And another thing that I want to say, I mean, I heard at least three of us, I don't remember if you said or not, but I heard two of you, I'm sorry. I heard two of you, I'm not sure about the senator, but I also voted in favor of medical marijuana in my state in 2001. I have an aunt right now in last stages of breast cancer, fully metastasized through her body and in her brain, and she's suffering. And if that poor woman wants to smoke joints all day, every day, more power to her because she's suffering. And I have never been opposed to that compassionate care. What I've seen is an abuse and misuse of the system that I think is very unfortunate and sad for those patients who legitimately could benefit. And what I see in this system is something that is sad, that's an abuse and misuse of an idea that I think initially started out as a good philosophical approach, but the way that it's being carried out is really unfortunate. And I think there's some intentional abuse there, and I don't like seeing that. So to hear that, you know, that we're all here against, I want to just make clear you understand, not against some of the ideology behind decriminalization, I'm voted for that too. It's the way that this is being put out there, it doesn't work that way. And that's the problem, and just be very careful to understand that. And what I said all along, because, you know, there's people who have taken some of my quotes and said, prohibition is to McGuire. I have never said prohibition. What I said is, we don't know enough about this yet. We're not ready. We're taking way leaps up and putting the cart before the horse. In a lot of ways, we don't know what we don't know. And until we know about DUI, until we know how to get our hands around the issues with kids, until we understand limiting the potency and differentiating. Let me also say this. I know I'm kind of going on the rabbit trail. I think it's important to say this. When you get butane hash extractions, and you get those products, those super hyperpotent products, in my opinion, that ceases to be pot. So what I say is, I think it's really unfair to pot to call that pot. You know, and that sounds weird, but it's the God's honest truth. That's not cannabis anymore. That's freebasing. That's chemical enhancement. And that's given a really bad name to this whole thing. But when you write that in as the definition of cannabis, you're tricking people. And that's what I've got the fundamental problem with, is sell me what you're selling me, but don't trick me on the back end and then make it something else and then make me swallow it. Because that's what I have a problem with. So to educate you on that reality, I'm not going to apologize for that.
This question is for the district attorney. Are you against the use of alcohol? Should it be prohibited like marijuana is now?
If we could only moderate. Alcohol abuse tears families apart. And I'm going to give you a term of art here. It's not even art. Cannabis use disorder. Has anybody ever heard of cannabis use disorder? Yeah, just a few people. But we have a huge abuse of cannabis in our society, particularly as we're moving toward concentrates. So, you know, with alcohol, it causes a lot of problems. And I don't want to compare apples and oranges. I just want to say that the more we keep alcohol out of that growing population, that growing brain development, the better we are, whether it's alcohol, cannabis, or nicotine. And, you know, I think we should be working toward a society that knows how to cope with stress without taking a substance. So I'm opposed to any kind of substance abuse.
Question over here.
A comment, I guess. I would love to see the issues of legalization and commercialization separated. Because I think this ballot has been really confusing. We've learned a lot in the process, and we have a lot more to talk about with each other. But if Because I keep thinking that, you know, about half of us in the state want to legalize, about half of us don't. So what if we figured out a way to move from the decriminalization towards legalization, and then once we achieve that, if we decide to achieve that, then we can sit down with the marijuana industry from a place of power to start negotiating if we want to do business with them. Because so much of this is about doing business. So much of BQ4 is about, it's about commercialization. So giving away our power to decide community by community is not okay. Like, if you were doing business, if you were just doing business, you would never give away this much power to your business partner. So if we separate them out, you know, vote this down. Let's start figuring out what would make sense first towards legalization, and then I think it's really important, I guess I can't remember said it, that there's a huge difference between opting out or opting in. And I think that the communities, especially who struggle, need to be protected. They shouldn't automatically be obligated to the commercial market. So,
did you want to have one of the panelists respond to that particular?
Sure. But that's, you know, let's separate the issues so we can see them clearly. Because right now it's.
Which panelist do you think you'd like to hear from?
Thanks. No, you actually raise a very good point. And if you look at the commercialization issue, let's look at tobacco and alcohol. Let's look not too far in the distant past, Joe Hamp. So look at a situation where, from an alcohol perspective, you know, there's more control. You know, you have to opt in that you're of age to even get on a website, which I know anybody can do, but the reality is the controls for an underage individual. You know, the situation we heard about in terms of the attempts all our local police departments are doing, having underage individuals try to order, whether it's in a restaurant, a bar, or even in a package store. One of the most ironic things to me is it is illegal for someone under 18, now under 21, thank you, in many communities, to purchase cigarettes. So a police officer can go to that store and indicate, I'm sorry, you are now losing your license to sell because you sold for someone who's under the age of, say, 18. But on the way walking in the store, the police officer walks by an individual who's 14 years old, who's sitting there smoking, standing there smoking cigarettes. And there's no issue in terms of legality of use. So from a commercialization perspective, I agree, but commercialization was certainly treated differently for tobacco use than it was with alcohol. And as a result of some of the pushback, the Joe Camel figure disappeared. We saw more of a response. And so my fear is to do the legalization, then address commercialization later, is kind of doing it backwards. And my fear is because of what we saw in Colorado. So when I'm seeing those cookies, when I'm seeing those gummy bears, when I'm seeing Girl Scout cookies, clearly there's an attempt to market and target children and individuals. And that's where we should. Before we look at legalization, it seems to me that the targeting of the minors and the individuals who are not permitted to purchase should not be permitted at all.
Actually, John, stay right here, because I think this next one you can answer to. The question is, if a community goes through the special election to opt out, how does that affect home grows?
It does not, correct?
Right.
It does not affect home grows. Home grows really are exempt. But you're looking at the commercial sales.
Okay. Great. Question over in the front row, and then back to you, Dennis. Yes.
So I'm a student at the University of Massachusetts. And from Pennsylvania. Last year, I'm a freshman year now. And I had some friends in high school who were arrested for smoking in public. They were being careless and got arrested. So they got a 6-month probation period, which is customary for underage usage in Pennsylvania. So during their probationary period, they weren't able to, obviously, smoke weed, so they turned to other alternatives that they probably would not have used if not put on this probationary period. So I was wondering, from your perspective, is it like really worth it to have this like prohibition that causes people actively to seek out other alternatives?
Well, the district attorney to answer that, he's coming up here, so I think he will answer that.
Here's the greatest myth about this argument for legalization. 2008, as you saw, it was decriminalized. If you were caught smoking in Massachusetts, you will not be arrested, you will not be prosecuted, you will not be incarcerated, you will not be put on probation. And I want to address one issue that's been raised as a red herring, that there's a racial disparity with marijuana in Massachusetts. 0 times 0 times 0 equals 0 racial disparity. And in fact, there won't be under this law that would be passed any racial disparity. So it doesn't exist. You wouldn't be put on probation. In fact, you can give your name, unfortunately, that referendum that was written, okay? You can give Donald Duck as your name, and we can't do anything about it. So in this jurisdiction, to the best of my knowledge, for possession of 1 ounce or less, at least during my tenure, we have never prosecuted a single case, nor will we. And so you should, in Massachusetts, remember this referendum, this ballot initiative is for Massachusetts. So you're going to hear a lot of scare tactics, particularly on criminal justice. And the thing that burns me is if you read the first line of this ballot initiative description, it says veteran law enforcement are in favor. Veteran law enforcement may be 0.1%, but the Massachusetts Chiefs Association, the Massachusetts District Attorneys Association, all the significant law enforcement do not want this to happen for two main reasons: operating while impaired under marijuana, and about the diversion to youth. And so those are the real issues. So I'm sorry you were put on probation. You're in Massachusetts. You would not have been arrested or put on probation, okay?
What about the question? Could you answer the question, please?
The question was about what?
Is it really worth having this prohibition if actively causes people to switch to other alternatives when they're not able to be using what they choose to use?
Oh, yeah. This is a reasonable law that's on the books now that restricts the commercialization of marijuana. And to say, you gave an example of you were put on probation and you switched to maybe to another substance. I think what you heard from the two folks here, Joe McGuire and to Dr. Poti, they're going to take whatever substance they want. There isn't that switch that they've experienced. So, you know, I would say it's a hypothetical question that doesn't have any significance because it just doesn't happen normally, you know. And the fact that substance abuse is substance abuse, take your pick, you know. And you look like a thriving young gentleman from University of Mass, okay? Now, I look at 3 proposed medical marijuana facilities in Amherst. That law was written for debilitating illnesses, okay? That's why I was in favor of it. Not the ballot initiative, because there was a big hole in it, but I was in favor of, you know, helping people that have debilitating illnesses. 1 in 25,000 students at UMass developed debilitating illnesses. They did. That's about making money off of medical marijuana and really undercutting, as Joe said, the real purpose. We do not want people to have human suffering, and that's why we're in favor of medical marijuana. But when you look at this law, it's about, I want you to succeed. And you're going to compete in a world marketplace. When you look at the rates of marijuana use around the world, even in Mexico, it was produced an incredible amount. The social norm is against it. Google marijuana use of teens and adults in Mexico.
you're going to see one-fifth the rate, okay? It's not going to be 25-30%. It's really low because that society knows better, and we should know better too.
Okay, the next question on the card that I have, I'm going to ask Joe to answer because she can speak from the Colorado perspective. What can we do in Massachusetts to ensure that edibles are not allowed or are clearly not appealing to youth if question four passes?
That's really going to depend on how the regulatory statutes are enforced. So if the regulatory commission makes those choices, then you have those options. Oregon was very restrictive on the edibles. They're not allowed to be attractive to children. They can't be in bright colors. They have to have special markings. So it's up to the state of Massachusetts to determine that. However, you cannot, under my understanding, is you can't ban edibles because they're guaranteed in the statute already. They're part of the definition. So you cannot say no edibles, but the regulatory oversight could put rules in place. That having been said, what's written into your law, and if you want to address this, you could probably do a better job than I can, but the commission is it nine members from the industry? And six not in the industry. So when you have a 9-6 vote with nine being from the marijuana industry, I don't know what your chances are of winning that, because what I saw in Colorado is the same players from Marijuana Policy Project that were representative at the table fought those things. So like when we said we have to have childproof packaging because of these child poisonings, they fought the standards, so we got the lowest possible allowable standard for childproof packaging, which was a Ziploc bag. So unfortunately that happens. I wish it did not happen. Maybe you'll have a different experience. I hope that's the case, but it'll depend on what the regulatory board decides to do.
Point of information?
Yes.
The 15-member board is an advisory committee.
15 members is an advisory committee. The actual commission that has power to vote on these things, like restricting advertising and things, is a three-member board appointed by the government. Has nobody from the industry in it.
Okay. I think the woman in the back there, did you? Yes. You
did have a question, but yes. This gentleman can ask about his question first.
Okay.
I'll go next.
This is for Senator Seibeck. You had talked, you had mentioned that the rate of taxation was half of Colorado's and that was very low. You also talked about how the black market and the gray market was flourishing in Colorado. You keep saying that we shouldn't rush into this and that, you know, we don't have all the information. Colorado has had 2 years of legalization, and the governor, Hickenlooper, who I believe that you work for, he's actually come out now in favor of legalization. When he asked if he could wave a magic wand and undo the legalization, he said, "I'm not so sure I would wave it. It's beginning to look like it may work." But my question for you is, do you understand that the taxation rate is so low in Massachusetts because it's an attempt to eliminate that gray and that black market? That's why the taxation rate is so low. It was an informed decision to try to eliminate this black market because the taxation rate in Colorado was so high that it was able to persist.
Do you want Representative Seibeck to answer that?
Yes, please.
In the time that I've been in the legislature, the first pieces of legislation, actually, it was sponsored by Representative Story from Amherst, Dick Evans, pushing it, and the legislation said that what we wanted to do was actually increase. The whole purpose of this was to generate revenue. So the question is, what's the goal? And the question or the concern that's been raised in the last week by the governor, by the Senate president, and by the speaker is looking at the numbers and look at proposed revenue coming out of this. It's a situation of, will the fees associated, will the taxes that are generated be sufficient to do the monitoring and everything else that was proposed in the proposal, or proposed to exist. Similarly, I mean, we faced a similar situation when expanded gaming happened, and the gaming commission looking at what the taxes were going to be. So it's a similar scenario. I don't think that the purpose here in Massachusetts was, at least in terms of legislators looking at it, and even the governor looking at it, that we're going to set the tax so low as to prevent the gray or black market. The issue was, what's as it was initially told and sold to us, the revenue is to be self-sufficient. And there's a question right now as to whether it can be self-sufficient. But that's another, you raise a question. And again, it's a question, what is our goal? If the goal is to prevent the gray and black market, then perhaps the tax should be low. But that's not going to be addressed in the next the next 2 weeks. And again, I'm not sure that people are making informed decisions at all levels, and that all of the eventualities have been discussed and considered before we leap off that cliff. There's no compelling reason why we have to do it this November and pass it right now. What's the harm and what's the issue in terms of looking to ensure that we don't have the marketing of the edibles that we saw in Colorado? What's the problem in terms of waiting to ensure that we identify and are able to address the issue of impaired driving? What's the problem in terms of ensuring that the system that we put into place is self-sufficient, particularly in light of the fact that we've got a governor that's talking about doing 9C cuts, which are cuts to associate other budget items during this current fiscal year, because revenues aren't matching up to where they should be. So is the goal of this to provide access to the public in terms of recreational marijuana as a drug of choice? That's one possibility. Is the choice to look at this as a revenue stream, just as gaming, just as property taxes are? It's another choice. Is the stream to try to protect health and safety and welfare of the populace? That's a third choice. And fourth is, what do we do to protect our young children? And should we be protecting our young children? What's the driving force? And I'm not sure that there's unanimity in terms of addressing that.
Actually, I can add something to the black market concern, and that's something that hasn't been talked about as much. But Joe, you can probably comment on this, but after legalization in Colorado, I believe applications for medical licenses skyrocketed, and the reasons that people were investigating for the Department of Public Health in Colorado were that you had a recreational legal marijuana, which was taxed pretty highly, and then non-taxed medical marijuana. And so that what that did is it increased dramatically black market marijuana, because marijuana is not a prescription drug, so you can pharmacy shop as much as you want, get as much as you want from as many pharmacies as you want, and then divert it, because you're buying it at a cheaper price than you would at a recreational place.
That's correct.
Okay, yes.
Hi. So my question is a little bit different. It's actually you, sir, the host of the evening. I came out to an educational informative meeting, and I certainly have gotten, everybody that has presented has done a wonderful job presenting what they believe is right. I'm curious as to why the Gazette, I don't read the Gazette, I don't get it, where we live. I'm curious as to why, or maybe you already did, why would you have an educational informative meeting such as this and host that and sponsor it, and not have anybody from the other perspective? If I just walked out the door and didn't ask this question, I would walk out assuming that the Gazette did this to promote No on 4. So was like the president of the Senate, who just came out and said that he was voting yes on question 4, any other proponents of question 4, were they invited? Did they decline to come? Or was this meant to be just a No on 4 forum?
All right, I'll answer that question. And I need to be clear in saying that I am not here in a Gazette role tonight. I was asked to moderate this by the organizers of this forum. I mean, many of you know me because I worked at the Gazette for many years. So clearly, I am associated with the Gazette. The Gazette and the Recorder and others sponsored a forum a couple of weeks ago that was held up at Greenfield Community College on question four. Some of you may have been there. Some of our panelists were there. At least the district attorney was there as a panelist. So we've done our four, the Gazette. This was organized by a coalition of health-related groups in the community.
Thank you.
Okay, any other questions in the audience? Yes?
So the information you put up about when it was made recreational was 2014. So leading up to that, people could not purchase recreational marijuana if they were 21 and older. And every chart that you put up of the statistics of basically people are underage using it, impaired driving, growing up there, all those statistics were from the years 2012, 2013. So all your information about associating cannabis use and legalized cannabis with increased impairment, all of that information that you posted up there today was from before it became legalized. If you look at a country like Portugal, which decriminalized drugs many years ago, if you look at their addiction rates, all of those things went down. So you're taking information from 2 years of legalized usage in Colorado, and you're contrasting that all into these very fine statistics, and all night you guys have been throwing facts at us. In the same way that you get facts in a debate on television, it's a politics of fear. You're not throwing real facts in our faces.
Okay, so hold up. I just want to be clear. Let's be clear. When you looked at my slides, they went up to straight up to 2015.
But that's still 1 year. It's
no,
not,
no, no,
it's not
no.
A,
I did those statistics from the Rocky Mountain Hydro Report. Some of those were 2006 to 2015, some were 2008 to 2015, depending on the data tracking. Wait, let me finish. So the majority of those statistics, especially driving, went 2006 to 2015. That was up to this last year. So we only have a few years of data, but I've given you the absolute most up-to-date data. Now, Portugal didn't guarantee a supply chain, and that's the biggest difference. Portugal decriminalized and legalized without guaranteeing a supply chain. We have not done that. We're doing something completely different. It's not apples to apples. When you allow home grow and then you write into the law guaranteed retail outlets, that's mandated. That is a different model. And so it's not the same thing. But that data, and if you want
my addiction
slides,
legalization
goes
is the same
straight
thing.
Up. It goes straight up to 2015. So you know, we're not going to get into all those other right now because we're actually past time, but you're talking about a different product. And again, Portugal has not seen the products that we have seen. This is something completely different. So bear that in mind. But those stats came right up to 2015 where we have that data. That's all I'm saying.
Okay, we need to leave the room because the Senior Center has to clean it and close. Thank you.